right, thanks. Welcome back. Welcome to those of you who are new. We are up to day four of my day. We are finally off of stuff on Hegel, stuff on Nietzsche, stuff on difference and repetition, and we're up to Anti-Oedipus. Anti-Oedipus, as hopefully you know, is a book that Deleuze writes with Felix Guattari, who was a Lacanian-trained psychoanalyst and a, I guess, self-proclaimed political radical, what is called a political radical. I believe they met around 1967 or 68, and the book, which was published in 1972. If you want it on, sure. Okay. This might be better. I could also just speak louder. That would be another alternative. Whichever you prefer. Okay, that'll be better. All right. The book was published in 1972, but is in many respects seen as a book following along in the spirit of and kind of representing Deleuze and Guattari's reactions to May 68 in France, which saw quite spontaneous uprising of protests, including students and workers and so forth, that none of the Marxists seemed to realize was coming, and it kind of caught everyone by surprise. And in certain respects, people think that it didn't accomplish anything, which is something that Deleuze and Guattari will write in a later book. People didn't recognize the effects that it had at a molecular level, which is a term that they use, both Anti-Oedipus and A Thousand Plateaus. So the subtitle of both this work and A Thousand Plateaus is Capitalism and Schizophrenia. One of the key theses is that capitalism and schizophrenia go hand in hand, that a capitalist system produces something called schizophrenia, that they call schizophrenia. This is not to be confused with medical schizophrenia. It's a schizophrenic process, which they talk about. And we'll try and describe that in a little bit. And it's a process in Anti-Oedipus linked to the unconscious. The unconscious is structured by a schizophrenic machinic process, which they will say is oftentimes overlaid and repressed and controlled by being overlaid by an Oedipal structure. Right? So the book is Anti-Oedipus, and it's an analysis in part about how capitalism and schizophrenia are work hand in hand, or capitalism and schizophrenic processes, but also a critique of psychoanalysis and the way in which it is complicit with the processes of capitalism. All right. As I said, Guattari is a Lacanian-trained psychoanalyst. He was a student of Lacan's. The story is always very nervous about the publication of Anti-Oedipus and how Lacan would react to it. So it's worth going back to Lacan, who you remember I was mentioning in the keynote lecture I gave, and I said we would get back to it today. To get to Lacan, we need to look back again at Hegel and that thing called the master-slave dialectic as such, but the thing that prefigures the master-slave dialectic and sets up the whole idea of recognition and reciprocal recognition, which is the statement that Hegel makes that self-consciousness is desire in general, that the structure of self-consciousness is a structure of desire. Now, the way in which this can be explained is, Kojev explains it quite well, desire has kind of two modes or two forms. And the reason why self-consciousness is called by Hegel the structure of self-consciousness is that of desire in general is because desire will be defined by Hegel as a movement of negativity, a movement of negation, and actually a twofold movement of negation, which leads to this whole dialectic of separation and unity. Right? It precedes the statement that Hegel will make just before the beginning of the master-slave dialectic, that self-consciousness gains its self-certainty only in relation to another self-consciousness. But the reason why that is the case is because of the structure of desire. Right? So Kojev refers to desires having taken two forms of negativity. The first is a kind of natural desire, the desire to negate objects outside of me by possessing them or consuming them, so forth, right? Just like an animal consumes food and satisfies a desire in that way, right? There is a second kind of desire, which is what's the one which is linked to self-consciousness itself, which Kojev will call. Turn it down a little bit, just okay. No, just because it's echoing a bit. Has a bit of feedback. That Kojev will refer to as the desire to be desired, and what makes human self-consciousness different from an animal's relation to the world, just the natural desire, is it's a desire not to have an object, but a desire to be valued as an object of desire by another. Right? So that is the properly human desire, and it's a desire to be recognized. Right? And the claim in Hegel is that this requires a kind of mutuality, that in order to be I want to become an object of desire by another, it has to be another self-consciousness, because otherwise it wouldn't mean anything to me. So the master gets recognition from the slave, but that doesn't satisfy his desire for recognition. You know, you might have a pet dog or cat that shows you affection and love and recognizes you in that sense, treats you as an object of desire in some way. You know, that's not enough to satisfy your human need to be treated as an object of desire by another self-consciousness, right? And so this is a second kind of negation, right? Ultimately, it's a negation of subjectivity in order to get subjectivity back, right? The first kind of desire is an assertion of one's subjectivity over the world, right? To consume things and the like, to negate their independence. The second, and this is a tricky thing, this is why the master-slave dialectic goes the way it goes, is because what neither character realizes is it's not a negation of the other, it's a negation in the sense of myself, in order to get myself back through recognition. Right? One way to explain this, yeah, I have time, I'll just explain it. Many of you are at an age where you're searching and chasing around for your next partner, or for your life partner, or for some partner, whatever it is, all right? And this is a game which many people experience. There's somebody you like, and you try and get their attention. And you kind of assert yourself. You show yourself big, strong, and tough, or beautiful, or whatever it is. And there's a game that's played, right? The more in which you kind of assert yourself, the more in which the other person kind of plays hard to get. You know this game? We've all experienced this game. In a way, it's the game of one person kind of asserting themselves as a subject, trying to take possession of the other, in a way, and the other one becoming kind of less, more and more passive in a way, right? More and more like an object, all right? And kind of untouchable in that sense, because they're not giving the recognition back. And if you play this game, you know that there's a funny reversal that sometimes happens. When you're the pursuer, as soon as you stop pursuing, the other one was like, the next time he or she sees you, oh, hi, right? And suddenly they're chasing you, and then you play the game back, right? It's one of these funny little games which are enjoyable for a little while, but yeah. What neither party in that position will do is take a risk, right? You know, the risk of that's supposed to make the relationship work is I risk kind of my subjectivity by risking being rejected, by like actually kind of saying, you know, I really like you, in the hopes that the other person will kind of make the same risk and say, I like you back, right? And it's that kind of recognition will require this kind of this risk of subjectivity. But once it's established, once you both say, I like you too, and you know, see the end of any Hollywood romantic comedy movie, and you know how the rest of it goes, right? Okay. Hegel says that he doesn't put it in these terms, obviously, but a certain kind of society establishes this reciprocity, right, where people kind of give their subjectivity over to get it back through this kind of reciprocal relationship. I mean, as I put it, in other forms, it also means a kind of recognition that no matter how different each of us is, that we can see each other, we can see ourselves in the other, vice versa. Right? Now, the reason to explain it all that way is there's a negation and then a negation of the negation. Lacan will define desire differently as a different kind of negation that goes beyond these two. Right? What makes desire for Lacan is it involves something which is irreconcilable with any kind of dialectic. Right? So it involves something more than either the demand to possess an object or the demand for recognition. Right? It goes beyond the two negativities in Hegel's notion of desire. Right? And Lacan explains it as a kind of reversal that takes place, which is different from or exceeds the negation of the negation. The negation of the negation is recognition. This is a kind of reversal that, in fact, actually even undermines the possibility of recognition. The way Lacan will describe it is it's something that establishes our subjectivity, but in a way that also undermines it at the same time. All right? So how does Lacan explain it? He does so by distinguishing three things: need, demand, and desire. Right? And he ties them all to the creation of subjectivity in a different way than Hegel, but it's still wrapped up in what it is to be a subject. Right? Need comes about. Need is just my basic desires, what I want, right? What I need. Okay? Its kind of basic form is the infant that cries out for milk, right? But it could take, or you know, for nourishment, for attention, what have you, right? Lacan says we become a subject when we enter into language. We enter into language and we speak, we use I, right? I take up a position as a subject in language to articulate my needs to others. And what will happen then, he says, is that a kind of repression of the particularity of my needs takes place, because my needs have to be communicated to another, and that communication requires that we use common significations, right? So when I say I'm hungry, you can recognize what, you can understand what that means, because we both have there's an agreed meaning of some sort, all right? So our language can only speak in general terms that we agree on, that we both can understand, that we all can understand. It can't, therefore, speak to the particularities of each of our interests, each of our feelings, so on. Nietzsche says something similar when he talks about he links our becoming conscious to language. And he talks about how each of our experiences is absolutely particular, but as soon as they're brought into language, they no longer seem to be. Because there's something about language that can't really explain the particularity or even the singularity of our experiences. I think I mentioned it at the keynote lecture. You know, when you have to explain to a doctor, you know, what's feeling wrong with your knee or something, you can't find the words for it. You know, there are like very specific particularities the language doesn't really capture. So this is the cost of being able to communicate in language. I become a subject, but I cannot express the particularity of my needs when I communicate them to others. Lacan will say that a second thing also emerges from this, which is because I'm using universal signifiers, I'm also in a sense making a universal demand, right? A demand for recognition, right? Because that's what subjectivity is wrapped up in, right? The desire for recognition, which Lacan will say is the demand for recognition, right? Which is the demand for love. So when the child uses language to express its needs to its mother, it's also making a demand for recognition and for love from its mother, right? You know, I'm not just saying feed me, I'm saying show me that you love me, right? And that corresponds to the second aspect, the desire to be desired, right? Because you want your mother to, you know, it's not like you want your mother to just toss you meat like you are an animal asking for food, right? You want your mother to show you some compassion when she feeds you. Or your father, right? You know, these gender roles are not necessary. Fathers can feed their children too. Sometimes it just has to come out of a bottle of formula instead, right? Or you need need to take special hormones so that men can lactate. Apparently, this can be done. A friend, a colleague of mine, who also became a father a little bit before me, we had this discussion. Would we contribute to raising our child, our children, by taking the drugs so that we could lactate? Anyway, we both decided against that. Where was I? Getting back to where I was. Because we have to get onto Deleuze and Guattari too, don't we? The second aspect is the demand for recognition. Lacan will say that the excluded particularity, the thing that I can't speak when I'm articulating my needs and making my demands, will return as a desire beyond demand. And will return because there will always be something that's left out in the response. The idea is that love is meant to be universal. It's, you know, I love you for all time. It's